Hello, everybody, and welcome to the June 2015 Fertility and Sterility Journal Club Live Platform event. I'm Dr. Stephen Palter. I'll be your moderator tonight, and I'm the video and new media editor of Fertility and Sterility. It's my pleasure to welcome you tonight to really one of our most exciting topics that we have. When we asked our viewers what they really wanted to hear about, OSI cryopreservation has always been at the top of the list. So our paper of interest tonight is optimal timing for elective egg freezing by the group from University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. We have a fantastic group of discussants with us, and our host department for this evening is going to be the University of Cincinnati. As always, we will have a free open discussion of the paper, and we really want to hear from you in the audience. We have close to 700 people registered. We want to know what you do, what your thoughts are, and what your questions are for the authors. And hopefully we'll come away from this with an understanding of how we should counsel our patients and apply OSI cryopreservation in our practices. I'm going to bring up our conflict of interest statement. And with that, I'm going to start to bring up our discussants so that we can introduce everyone to you. We have with us from the Colorado Center for Reproductive Medicine, we've got Dr. Suri and Skullcraft. Hi, guys. Welcome.
Hi there.
Thanks so much for joining us tonight.
It's a pleasure.
As always, we have the authors with us. Representing the authors is Jenny Messero and Tolga Messin from the University of North Carolina. Thanks so much for putting your paper on the line and telling us what you guys did. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for inviting us.
We always want to have someone from a lab perspective. We have with us Kimball Pomeroy from the World Egg Bank. Kimball, thanks for joining us.
It's my pleasure. Thanks.
And along with us on our clinical discussants, we've got Diana Wu from the Oregon Health Science University. Hi, Diana.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
It's my pleasure. And as always, to have another clinical perspective, we've got the West Coast, we've got the East Coast also, we've got Nicole Noyes with us from NYU. Nicole, welcome and thanks for joining us.
Again, thank you for letting me be here.
And now to our stars of the evening, we've got the University of Cincinnati Reproductive Endocrine Division. Welcome, guys. I'm going to turn it over to Michael Thomas, who's going to introduce his group, and then he's going to start with giving us a background on OSI cryopreservation and then present the paper.
Hi, guys. This is Mike Thomas from the University of Cincinnati. Thank you. Topic. We feel very honored to be involved. I am a professor and the fellowship and division director here at the University of Cincinnati. With me tonight, I'll sort of go in order. I have one of our OBGYN residents all the way to my right, Dr. Gordon, Dr. Shroga, assistant professor and head of our oncofertility program, Dr. Christine DiPaolo, who's our IVF medical director and assistant professor here, our second-year fellow, soon to be third-year fellow, Dr. Izzy Robertshaw is here to my left, joining us this year. Dr. Chanel Adams, who came to us from the University of Hawaii, and to her left is Dr. Margaret Boudreau, one of our residents, Dr. Hurley, one of our residents, and Dr. Boyd, one of our other residents. With that, we'd like to start out by giving an overview of OSI freezing. Dr. Adams will start with that.
Thank you very much, Dr. Thomas. Aloha, everyone. More than 50% of assisted reproductive clinics in the United States report offering OSI cryopreservation, and the most common indication is elective to defer childbearing. Cryopreservation is the preservation of cells or tissues by the process of cooling to sub-zero temperatures, stopping all biological activity and preserving for future use. In the mid-20th century, pioneers in cryopreservation succeeded in producing live offspring from rabbit and rodent oocytes. In 1984, the first human birth from a frozen embryo was reported. 2 years later, the first birth from a frozen oocyte was reported. Historically, oocyte survival, fertilization rates, and pregnancy rates have been low. But over the last decade, advancements in cryopreservation technology have greatly improved cryopreserved oocyte viability. The two major techniques for cryopreservation are slow freezing and vitrification. Slow freezing has been shown to be inferior to vitrification. Vitrification is a technique that uses high initial concentrations of cryoprotectant and ultra-rapid cooling to solidify cells in a glass-like state, preventing the formation of potentially hazardous ice crystals. In general, oocytes are more sensitive to cryopreservation damage than embryos. M2 oocytes are fragile due to their large size, water content, and chromosomal arrangements. In 2010, a prospective randomized study comparing slow freeze versus vitrified oocytes showed significantly higher fertilization rates, leakage rates, embryo morphology, and clinical pregnancy rates in vitrified oocytes. In fact, oocyte survival rates were 81% compared to 67% in slow freeze. Vitrification, gold standard for oocyte cryopreservation. It's superior to slow freeze oocytes and has comparable outcomes to the fresh oocytes. A 2013 prospective study looking at donor egg cycles for fresh versus vitrified recipients showed no difference in fertilization rate, ongoing embryo rates, high-quality embryos, implantation, clinical pregnancy per transfer, and live birth rates. Multiple studies have confirmed that vitrified oocytes are comparable to fresh oocytes, but most of these studies are done in donor oocytes with short interval of cryopreservation. This data is not applicable to women seeking fertility preservation for age-related concerns. However, in a 2013 prospective study in women 30 to 39, it showed no difference in fertilization, day 3 embryo quality, blastocyst formation, and when they were comparing mature sibling oocytes randomized to vitrified versus fresh. The overall efficacy to achieve live birth rate was 5.9% per oocyte, meaning it took 16.9 vitrified oocytes to achieve a live birth in this age group. When it was further stratified down by age, looking at young women, 30 to 36, and more advanced age, 37 to 39, there was no statistical difference of survival rates, fertilization, implantation, clinical pregnancy, and live birth rates. But the live birth rates per vitrified oocyte was 8.2% in the young group and 3.3% in the more advanced group, meaning that 12.1 vitrified oocytes were needed to achieve a live birth in the young group, while you needed 29.6 in the older group. In reviewing the literature, there's no increased risk of congenital anomalies or aneuploidy in births from cryopreserved eggs. A recent retrospective study this year showed, with 2-to-1 age match controls that looked at 33 patients, low freeze and vitrified oocytes, the median age of cryopreservation was 3.5 years. Oocytes were thawed, cultured, trophectoderm biopsies were performed, and PGS was performed. There was no difference in fertilization, number of euploid blastocysts, implantation, ongoing pregnancy rates. Per the most updated ASRM guidelines on mature oocyte cryopreservation, though oocyte cryopreservation is no longer to be considered experimental and has been shown to be safe and effective in select populations, more data is needed before this technology can be used routinely. There's not sufficient data to recommend oocyte cryopreservation for the sole purpose of circumventing reproductive aging in healthy women, as there is little to no data to support the safety, efficacy, ethics, emotional risk, or cost effectiveness. The aim of this study being presented tonight is one step toward answering two of these questions, efficacy and cost effectiveness. And with that, I'll turn over the floor to my colleague, Dr. Robertshaw, who will give us a synopsis of the article.
Good evening, and thank you again for the opportunity to host this month's Journal Club Live from Cincinnati, Ohio. We are very excited to discuss this study because of its relevance in today's society, as women are attempting childbearing at a later age. This delay is largely due to social and economic factors, which are, as the authors have stated, comes at the cost of an increase in age-related infertility. Oocyte cryopreservation has been demonstrated to be a viable method for fertility preservation for single women who are not ready to conceive, as Dr. Adams has eloquently reviewed. This retrospective study was exempt from the University of North Carolina Institutional Review Board, proposes a decision tree model to better understand the live birth rate and financial cost of performing oocyte cryopreservation, or OC, versus taking no action and instead, in the future, undergoing unassisted conception attempts for 6 months followed by traditional IVF. The model proposed mimics the progression of a woman to a decision about OC for social indications in order to attempt conception by the horizon age of 3, 5, or 7 years later. Two models were created. Model A assumes a woman will only attempt to conceive after marriage and is unwilling to use donor sperm. Given this assumption, this model includes the probability of marriage by the horizon age, which was calculated using the National Survey of Family Growth. Model B assumes women will attempt pregnancy at the horizon age regardless of marital status. The models grouped patients as choosing OC or choosing unassisted conception at a later time for 6 months, followed by traditional IVF. Both models analyzed the probability of unassisted conception after 6 months of attempts at horizon age using the ongoing time to pregnancy study being conducted, including over 600 women. The miscarriage probability, as calculated using the prospective National Registry Linkage Study of 1.2 million pregnancies in Denmark. The 2011 CDC ART National Summary Report, with outcome data from over 100,000 fresh non-donor IVF cycles in the U.S., was used to calculate the live birth rate of women choosing OC at decision age, denoted in the paper as IVF-OC, and live birth rate with traditional IVF at horizon age, denoted as IVFT. Using IntegraMed system database, which includes over 33,000 IVF cycles performed in the years 2003 to 2013, the live birth rate of the second and third IVF OC cycle and the live birth rate of the first and second FET cycles for those who did not conceive with IVFT were calculated. To do this, the authors first identified the total number of oocytes available for cryopreservation at the decision age by identifying women with a diagnosis of male and tubal infertility, which were presumed to have an oocyte yield similar to the age-matched women undergoing retrieval for elective oocyte cryopreservation. Then the assumption was made that women with less than 8 oocytes were eligible for only one cycle, while women with 8 to 16 oocytes were eligible for a second, and women with greater than 17 were eligible for a third. With regards to the live birth rate for the first and second FET cycles, the authors assumed it was similar to IVFT. The probability of having no, one, or two FETs was estimated by compiling the number of frozen embryos available and the 2012 ASRM committee opinion for embryos to transfer per FET based on unfavorable criteria. Both models were run at each decision age from 25 to 40 years old, allowing for an age-based estimate of live birth rate and cost per live birth. With regards to the cost analysis, the direct charges such as cost of medications, laboratory analyses, medical services, and procedures were included in the model and adjusted to the $2014 with the use of the Consumer Price Index. Indirect costs such as loss of productivity or pregnancy-associated costs such as miscarriage, preterm delivery, and higher order multiples were not included. The authors determined that a live birth rate of 10% was clinically significant and a probability of live birth of greater than 70% was considered excellent. An incremental cost effectiveness ratio, or ICER, was calculated as a ratio of overall difference in cost in each group. This was interpreted as cost per additional live birth when performing OC. One-way analysis were performed on all of the variables on decision ages, with the largest difference in live birth rate and the lowest ICER. And a 50% range of the base case value was assumed only when precise range of cost or probability was unknown. The results of this study demonstrate that Model A, the greatest difference in live birth rate with regards to OC was 5.6% at 35 years of age, with a live birth rate of 14.7 in the OC group and 9.1 in the no OC group at 7 years horizon age. The largest live birth rate was seen at the ages of 25 to 30 with a 53.5% versus 32.3%. OC was found to be most cost effective at age 35, but higher in cost with ICERs of greater than $196,000. It was least cost effective in 25-year-olds with ICER of greater than $360,000. In Model B, the greatest difference in live birth rate with OC was 29.7% at 37 years of age, with a live birth rate of 51.6% versus 21.9%. Live birth rate was lowest at the age of 40 at 26.2%. Similar to Model A, OC was most cost-effective at age 37, but higher in cost with an ICER of greater than $28,000 at age 37 and greater than $400,000 at age 25. So in conclusion, the absolute benefit of OC in both models is low at less than 10% in young ages. Model A demonstrates no absolute benefit, which the authors conclude is a direct result of the decrease in marriage probability with age. Model B demonstrates absolute benefit in patients at 37 years of age, with an increase in live birth rate of 29.7% at 7 years horizon and less impact seen at ages 3 or 5 years horizon. However, live birth rate is relatively low at 37 years of age of 51.6% OC, was not cost effective for both models, which the authors concluded it was likely because there was a large initial cost to the individual. So therefore, the main message we think to this paper is that if the goal is to increase the live birth rate at any cost, then perform OC at age less than 34 years old and delay attempt at pregnancy to at least 7 years horizon age. However, if the goal is to maximize the cost effectiveness value of OC, then perform OC at 35 years of age if the patient is described to be in model A, and at 37 years of age if it's described in model B.
With that, we aren't going to show any mascots like my friend Dr. Price from last month, unlike our folks from Duke. But we do want to ask the first question to the authors. Dr. DePaul is going to ask the first questions to Dr. Massaro and colleagues.
Mike, before you get to that, let me give you a little bit of the background of some of our polls that we've been doing. First, I want to tell you a little bit about our audience tonight. We have 67% from the U.S., 13% from Canada, and 3% Europe, 3% South America, 3% Central America, 8% Africa, 6% the Middle East, and 8% from Asia. So we've got a real mix worldwide of people attending. We asked people, do you offer egg freezing to our worldwide audience? And 78% said yes, they do OSI cryopreservation, and 22% said no. And I think that this is a real statement to, you know, ASRM coming out with a statement that it's no longer experimental. You know, nearly 80% of the practitioners around the world are clinically offering this to our patients. Now, before we start, we ask people when they think it's most effective and most cost effective. And the audience said they felt that it was, before we get into this discussion of the paper, that it was most cost effective to freeze. 37% said under age 30. And 56% said between 30 and 35. So you have, you know, 90%+ people thinking you should do it under 35 and 37% saying under age 30. When we asked them, you know, what they think about success rates, they were saying that you should do it between age 25 to 30 or 30 to 35. So they're mirroring success rates and cost effectiveness. And so it'll be interesting when we talk about this paper to see if we change people's opinions. I wanted to just, before you get into the questions, go to our authors and just ask them in a few minutes if you could tell us, what was your goal in doing this study? You did a mathematical model here. What were you trying to answer and how were you trying to help people with this data?
Thank you for that great overview. So we had the question for the study because we have patients that come in, as do many of the viewers, and ask, should I bank my eggs? What is the likelihood that it's going to actually result in a pregnancy in the future? And if I don't bank my eggs, am I going to be able to get pregnant in the future? And to date, there's not a lot of prospective studies looking at success rates with banked eggs.
Okay. Great. And so in terms of a decision analysis, you know, you separated, you're not just talking about success, but you're talking about cost effectiveness. So is your goal to be able to have someone come out of this and be able to decide, you know, at what point do I pull the plug and do it if I'm single?
Yeah, I think the primary objective of the study was to, for the individual patient, and not necessarily looking at the cost effectiveness, but the effectiveness. As kind of a secondary marker, more of a societal view of it, is where the cost effectiveness comes into play.
Okay, fantastic. So I'm going to go back to the University of Cincinnati. And Mike, if you can start with your, have you start with your questions.
Okay, Dr. Christine DiPaolo is going to ask our first question to the authors.
Hi there. Dr. Messon and Dr. Mercero, I'd like to ask you the question of what was your rationale for the decision tree model? And were there any other models that you had considered? And if you could briefly let us know what you think.
So our rationale for the model was to try to mimic what we feel like patients have as their real decision. Should they bank now, or if they decide not to bank, what will be the chance of live birth if they're in that situation? There are a few prior published papers on this topic, and we thought that we could add some valuable information for the literature with this specific cost-effectiveness analysis. So one thing that we really aimed to do was to use a variety of ages at clinical presentation, so what we call decision age, so the age when they come in to discuss this, whether it be 25 or 35 or 40, that has a very different implication on the effectiveness of egg banking. The other thing that we wanted to do that prior studies haven't done is vary the length of time patients would consider coming back to actually attempt conception. So in our study, we looked at a 3-year horizon, a 5-year horizon, and a 7-year horizon. So for example, if someone presented at 37 and said she definitely wanted to try to have a baby by 42, this model allows us to provide an answer for that specific scenario. The other things that we thought were unique with our study were that we have a robust set of data going in as our probability assessments. So, for example, we use Dr. Steiner's time to conceive study to give rather robust estimates on the chance of natural conception at a variety of ages between 30 and 45. This is really the only great data out there looking at natural conception. And then the final thing that we wanted to look at was whether these patients were going to have a high likelihood of finding a partner with which they wanted to conceive, or would they be considering using donor sperm. So we actually partnered with a sociologist at UNC, Dr. Kane, and she used the National Survey of Family Growth to estimate marriage rates at each age group, looking at the horizon age, to try to determine if egg banking was going to be feasible for these women who were presenting.
We found that a lot of our patients don't really consider that option when asking about this technology. They assume they'll be with a partner in 3, 5, or 7 years, and this model allows us to look at both scenarios.
Right. So if I have it correct, you actually modeled at any age, if they're freezing, what's the likelihood that they would find a partner with societal data, what's the likelihood they would find a partner and get in order to use the eggs with, and then you did a backup analysis that said, if you don't, would you use donor sperm, correct?
Correct. Get married, yes. We didn't have data on partnering, but on marriage.
Right. Okay. So before we get to the next question, I want to welcome Dan Williams is with us from Houston Fertility. He's connected with us now. Welcome, Dan. We're glad to have you. And we also want to acknowledge Micah Hill from the NIH is leading our chat tonight. And we've got a robust debate going on, and we'll be bringing some of those questions to our panel. So, Mike, I'm going to turn it back over to you.
All right. We'd like to ask our next question to Dr. Raffensperger. Dr. Schroeder?
How do you currently counsel your patients regarding oocyte cryopreservation? Kind of what is the goal oocyte number that you counsel your patients on, and cost benefits and live birth rates?
Well, we'll take that first.
just a few questions.
Yeah, there's a lot of questions in that question, but certainly we start with a lot of the variables that have been in this study. Patient age, we emphasize ovarian reserve, because at any given age, their ovarian reserve will dictate their time horizon where they may have viable fertility, and then try to get an understanding of what they see as their life plan. Do they have any forecast to meet or marry in the next 2 years, 5 years, or indefinite? And those are the variables we use to decide, is freezing egg a good idea? Do they have an opportunity to wait at least a few years and still freeze eggs where their ovarian reserve is probably still intact? So I think one variable that wasn't in this paper that's critical is ovarian reserve, because we know that chronologic age is only a very rough marker of where patients' fertility is. And so we try to give them a forecast of how long might you remain fertile if you're currently 30 or 33 or 37, and therefore how does egg freezing fit into your plan? We talk obviously about the costs of an egg freezing cycle. Alternatively, if they were to consider an option like donor sperm IUI, what that cost looks like. So they have some feel of at least the two options to either get pregnant now or preserve their fertility for later on.
Bill, let me interrupt you for 1 second. Can you just tell us, people in the audience in the chat want to get a feel for kind of what you're telling people. So, you know, if you imagine you had a 30, 35, 37-year-old and you did the ovarian reserve, can you give us just a snapshot of how you would counsel them based on normal or abnormal ovarian reserve in their age, telling them should you freeze or not?
Well, at a 35-year-old, if they had abnormal ovarian reserve, I would tell them to freeze regardless of their time horizon. If they had good ovarian reserve, but they thought that it would be 3 years or longer, or past age 38, before they might even be in a position to get married, I would also tell them to freeze. So really at 35, the only people I wouldn't recommend freezing are people with good ovarian reserve that somehow have a crystal ball that they may be married and in a position to conceive within the next 2 to 3 years. And that's not too many of the folks I see. Usually they don't have a clue where their partner will come from or when.
And what if this ovarian reserve is bad? What if their ovarian reserve is poor?
Well, I mean, if it's diminished but still salvageable, I'd recommend immediate egg freezing. Of course, there's patients that have such diminished ovarian reserve that we would feel that their eggs are not viable at that point. So obviously, cryopreserving is of little value. And unfortunately, I have to counsel those patients that ultimately egg donor may be what they need.
Do you have a cutoff at which point you'd say, I don't think you should freeze your eggs?
Not absolutes, but you know, generally if they have less than 6 resting follicles, if their FSH is over 15, if their AMH is under 0.5, certainly if they're over 42, I guess those would be fairly absolute numbers.
Okay, great. Mike?
Question is directed to Dr. Williams, and that question is asked by Dr. Izzy Robertshaw.
Hi, Dr. Williams. In counseling patients, you discuss donor sperm and offer or recommend cryopreserving half oocytes and half embryos. Is there an age contributing factor to that?
That's a good question. So first I'd have to say that in dealing with oocyte freezing, particularly for social reasons, it is an insurance policy in that younger patients probably aren't expecting to actually even have to use the eggs in the first place. They're expecting to find a partner and possibly be able to conceive. So having said that, patients do freeze eggs because they want to have the chance to have their own biologic children with a subsequent partner that they may find. And certainly in the future, if they don't find such a partner, they can still use donor sperm with those eggs. And if they're younger, they should have more eggs, presumably, depending on ovarian reserve. And if they're older, they have less eggs. But that even really underscores the fact that really using those eggs and freezing them for their own use is probably a better form. And so we don't usually offer that they single women that are freezing eggs, that they use donor sperm to freeze the half embryo.
Okay, back to you, Cincinnati.
All right, the next question is directed to Dr. Wu, Dr. Adams.
Well, Dr. Wu, will this paper change your clinical practice on how you counsel patients who are in their 20s and 30s and come in asking about oocyte cryopreservation?
Oh, Dan, sorry, let me bring your mic got muted. Let me try and bring you up. You want to try again?
All right, Dr. Adams is going to ask our next question to Dr. Wu.
I think Dr. Wu was muted.
Oh, Dr. Mute Wu was muted. Sorry.
Yeah, we're trying to figure out. Diana, you may just need to unmute your mic up at the top. We're just having a problem hearing you, but we'll try and get you unmuted and try again. In the meantime, Mike, I'll have you ask just a different question to another panelist.
All right, our next question is directed to Dr. Noyes. And Dr. Hurley is going to ask that question.
Hi, Dr. Noyes. In the discussion, the authors noted in Model A, the use of OC was more cost-effective at age 35. While in Model B, the age was 37 years, if women proceeded with attempts at conception despite marital status. In your practice, does this two-year difference in age affect your discussion when the patient brings this paper to their office or to your office for their first visit? In other words, would you tell a 35-year-old interested in OC to come back 2 years later?
Well, first of all, I find the paper very interesting that they address marriage at all. I don't even ask patients if they're married anymore. I ask them if they're partnered. And I would guess, I speculate, less than half the patients who come, even for IVF, are married anymore in New York. I don't know how it is in the rest of the world, but in New York, I would say. And even in the discussion of your paper in 2011, I think you said 40% of births are born to unmarried women in America. So I don't, the married part, I don't think I would address much at all. But the unmarried, we call that Model B, I thought was very helpful. When you look at the figures, for instance, in Figure 2, you show the difference between people who freeze and don't freeze. And the gap widens pretty significantly when you look across, starting at 31. Sorry, I'm looking at the table. Starting at 31, the gap widens pretty significantly. So that at 31, you have about a 10% difference. At 33, you have a 20% difference. And at 37, you have a 30% difference. So you're showing a really, you know, big difference in whether you freeze or not, in whether you get a live birth. So again, as the author said, the live birth issue, I think, is more compelling to the patients than the cost effectiveness. Would I tell a patient, to answer your question, would I tell a patient who came at 35 to come back at 37 because it's more cost effective? Absolutely not. Again, if you look at their model, if they froze at 35 or they froze at 37, it was a 65% chance of live birth at 35 and a 52% at 37. So you lose, 13% chance of live birth. Why would you do that? I mean, unless you didn't have the money, why would you do that? Did that answer your question? Basically, if you're asking when I tell people to freeze, I ideally think people should freeze between 31 and 33. I think younger than that, the odds are they won't need to use them. And older than that, the pregnancy rate goes down enough that I think, you know, that's the window where I think it's ideal.
Nicole, I'm going to bring up something that just came up in the chat. We asked people, you know, for an older patient, would you ever discourage them from freezing their eggs and say, you know what, at this point, you should just use donor sperm and freeze an embryo? And 65% said yes, 35% said no, I would allow them to do egg freezing at any age, and I wouldn't discourage them. So would you ever discourage someone based on age or ovarian reserve that freezing their eggs isn't going to give them enough security? You know, do you have cutoffs like that you discuss?
Oh, definitely. So at our clinic, we've done 240 thaw cycles, 180 of them with women using their own eggs. The rest are donors, so in women using their own eggs. 13 of those were in women who were 41 to 42 years old, and 4 of those women ended up with a live birth. Over 42, we don't have any births from thaws. So our clinic soft cutoff, I mean, we never tell to someone, I'm sorry, you cannot freeze, but we really, really discourage over the age of 42. So I'm not sure what you're calling older. In New York, I would say 43 is older. As far as telling them to use donor sperm versus freezing eggs, only if a patient is willing to conceive with the donor sperm later. I really have an aversion to creating embryos just in case, particularly if someone isn't interested in using them later. And so many patients have a threshold of, no, I would not have a child on my own using donor sperm, or if I had a partner, I would not use these eggs with donor sperm. Having said that, I think you have greater efficiency with embryos than I do with eggs. So I think that if a patient sort of says, I just need to get a baby at any cost, and they're older, I would say it would be better to freeze an embryo than an egg. I do think they're more efficient egg for egg.
And then do you tell people, you know, we see, I mean, I'm in New York also, and we see the people who come in who've got a high FSH and they've got three antral follicles and maybe they do a maximal stimulation and get three eggs and they think, you know, that's going to be enough and you know it's not. How do you counsel the person that's freezing, that's getting less than five eggs?
Well, first of all, over the age of 35, we don't have anyone freeze anything. We don't even have people do IVF with high FSH levels. So 35 is our cutoff where you have to have an FSH of less than 13.5 and a reasonable AMH level. So I'm sorry, now I forgot what you're...
Right,
what you're,
so they, and what if someone got less than five eggs? Would you say to them, you know, this
isn't
enough?
You mean once the eggs were retrieved or at what point?
Yeah, they only make five.
If they made five and they were already in the dish, I would certainly freeze them. I mean, nope.
What do you tell her to do next? Because you know, you're worried that
with a subsequent cycle, you mean, or to preserve further, or
At what point? I guess what I'm trying to get at is, you know, people need to know from us when they should stop. How many eggs is enough?
Oh well, interesting. One of the abstracts we submitted to ASRM, we tried to calculate how many eggs you needed based on our data. And if you're 42, to sort of guarantee a live birth, it was approaching 50 eggs. So where do you stop? We said either people are going to run out the door or they're going to do 100 cycles if we tell them that. But, you know, it's hard to say. When you have older patients, so many of them don't get pregnant. So we don't encourage people to freeze over 42. That's all I can tell you. Or with poor ovarian reserve, ever.
Great. All right. That's really helpful. Mike, I'm going to bring it back to Cincinnati.
All right. We're going to try again to ask Dr. Wu the same question. Dr. Adams?
Can you hear me?
Yep, we got you.
Okay, great. I heard the question earlier. To answer, it's actually interesting, the average age of women pursuing elective egg freezing in our program in the last 2 years was 36. So really, the most of the patients I'm seeing and counseling are in their mid-30s. I think this paper does help in our counseling and conversations with women in their late 20s and early 30s that it may, you know, this choice may not make future economic sense in terms of the cost effectiveness, but there are certainly emotional, psychological, social, and perhaps physical benefits that are unaccounted for by just looking at the economics of it alone. I do routinely counsel patients in their late 20s or early 30s that they may, in fact, have no issues conceiving in the future and may not need the cryopreserved oocytes. I do think that there is one point that is worthwhile bring up here and that wasn't, you know, accounted for in this paper is the risk for secondary infertility. So women in their early 30s who delay childbearing for X number of years may still in their mid to late 30s have no issues with subfertility and conceive easily. But after 40 weeks of gestation and the now recommended 18 months of optimal intrapregnancy interval, may very well in their late 30s and early 40s experience secondary infertility, and perhaps that may be where the cryopreserved oocytes may be beneficial.
Okay. Cincinnati?
All right. Our next question is directed to Dr. Pomeroy. Dr. Boudreau.
Hi, Dr. Pomeroy. Can you discuss how and why pregnancy rates per lab may vary for oocyte cryopreservation?
Oh, let me just bring Kimball up and unmute his mic.
Yes, I think. Thanks. I think there's a couple places that we have to think about. Of course, there's vitrification and there's warming, where you could have different rates, not necessarily dependent upon what technique is used, but the skill level of each lab doing either the vitrification or the warming. I still think, though, because we still are in a nascent technology, that we need to also look at the carrier system for these oocytes and the storage of these oocytes and the shipping of the oocytes. And that there are things that can affect the final outcome if you don't pay attention to these. I can give you an example. We used a carrier system that we soon found out the cap would fall off very easily. that's not the type of system, although it makes excellent oocytes, it's not the type of system that you want to use if you're going to be shipping these oocytes around. As far as vitrification per se, I think it's a skill that has a learning curve, although I think the learning curve is fairly short. Most people are vitrifying blastocysts now, and that skill transfers pretty closely over to vitrifying oocytes. But warming of blastocysts, people that warm blastocysts very well, don't necessarily warm oocytes very well. The skill that is really necessary to learn, I think where there's the most variability, is the ultimate warming of those oocytes.
So do you, what do you see, if you deal with a lot of different centers getting banked eggs, can you comment to the differences you see between results, between different practices just doing the warming when they haven't even frozen it? What's the magnitude of the difference you see?
Well, when I've worked with places that I've spent time out training people to do the warming, I think this is what your question is asking about, we see some groups that this is basically new to them. They're not even vitrifying blastocysts now. That's a very tough group to get up to speed very quickly on warming oocytes. But even groups that do a lot of blastocyst warming, I think oftentimes people might tend to think that, oh, I already know how to warm blastocysts. Warming eggs, what's the difference? It's the same size, but it isn't. You have to pay more attention to the temperatures that you're working at, which sometimes gets lost, I think, in the technique. And you also have to be able to identify this oocyte very quickly because it turns transparent once it hits the warming media. So I think those are things that make it very difficult. We see some groups that can do it very easily the first time they try it. We see other groups, and it's probably because they don't do it enough, which is the other key, that they don't do it enough to develop the skills. So in most labs, we ask that those labs will identify one or two people that will do all of the oocyte warming. It's kind of like the beginning times of ICSI. You had to do enough ICSI in order to develop the technique and keep it. If you don't do enough, then you won't ever develop the technique very well.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I'm going to bring it back to University of Cincinnati.
Our next question is directed toward the authors again. Dr. DePaula?
Dr. Messon and Dr. Mercero, could you kindly comment on, would ovarian reserve markers like AMH affect your model?
Okay, let me just unmute you guys. Hang on 1 second. And I get, two of our groups alluded to this. Nicole said from NYU that they have a cutoff of 13.5. Schoolcraft said in Colorado that they would change how they counsel patients with poor reserve. What would you recommend?
So I think the AMH would have been an excellent variable to include in the model. We did, AMH is a surrogate for oocyte yield, and we did account for oocyte yield by using the number of times someone can go through either an FET cycle or a frozen oocyte cycle. And that's from real data. So on the back end and looking at the cost effectiveness, you take into account the AMH secondhand. As far as we have a cutoff, I'll defer to Dr. Mercer on that.
We don't have an absolute cutoff at our clinic. We'll often let women try to do a stimulation cycle with the understanding that if they're not making at least 3 good eggs, we'll recommend canceling before retrieval. The other thing is that our model was rather complex as is, and we didn't have a good way of estimating pregnancy rates with diminished ovarian reserve anyway, and so we really were not able to add that to our model, unfortunately, but we think that would be a really good future study.
Okay, guys. I'm going to ask, I'm going to go back to Mike in Cincinnati. Here you go, guys.
All right. Our next question is directed toward Dr. Suri and Dr. Schoolcraft. Dr. Shroga?
In different age ranges, is there a we kind of already asked this, but just getting another opinion, is there a goal number of oocytes that you would recommend banking for a patient?
Let me just unmute you guys. I think this is important because people keep asking us, you know, when we're in chat, we're having people say, if you were doing a public service announcement, what would you tell people? You know, should you freeze? When should you stop freezing? How many eggs is enough? I think a lot of people really want to know what the panelists are doing for this.
Well, I think that's a critical and a great question. I think part of it goes into some of what has been discussed already, which is the idea of where does the patient stand to begin with. The number of oocytes that you'd want to have frozen for a 32-year-old would be very different than what you would want for a 42-year-old, because you have to take into account the incidence of aneuploidy. So that I think the idea, and this kind of hooks back to how many cycles would one do, if you're going to only retrieve three eggs from a 42-year-old and assume that the inherent aneuploidy rate, once you get a blastocyst out of that, is going to be 80%, having only three eggs is really an exercise. And so I think it's very critical in looking at this paper and in general to understand, yes, we have a model, and mathematical modeling is great, but it is critical for each clinic to really have a sense of how they do. I mean, the inherent aneuploidy rate is going to be more or less constant. The ovarian reserve issues are going to vary from individual to individual, but it's critical for each clinic to know, what is our survival rate with oocyte vitrification? What is our blastocyst development rate? What is our implantation rate after that? And that goes into the counseling. So I think it's a little bit difficult to use a model based on more broad assumptions and a very large database for an individual clinic. It's sort of like using the national SART database for pregnancy rates to assume that's what your clinic is going to be if you've never done IVF before.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Eric. I'm gonna bring up something new now. We had a robust chat going, and one of the questions was identified by the group, something that they wanted a direct answer from, and Micah Hill from the NIH threw this back to us. And we have a new feature called the drop-in, and we have with us Joseph Doyle, who asked a question in chat that there was a lot of interest in. And so, Joseph, I'm going to see, we just pushed a button and brought him live, a member of our audience. We're going to broadcast his question to everyone. And Joseph, why don't you go ahead and ask the panelists your star question of the night?
Okay. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So I think Dr. Noyes has started to answer a bit about this already, but a common thing that we'll encounter, particularly where we're seeing people, is if you have a 42-year-old woman who comes in interested in electively freezing her eggs, and she's not ready to use donor sperm, and she's kind of holding out for the potential for a partner, and you inform her that generally we're not recommending that you freeze eggs at this point, and then kind of the common response that is kind of a challenge to address is, well, if I don't freeze my eggs, I know the chance is zero. So in a circumstance like that, would you consider freezing eggs?
So Joseph, why don't you tell us, since we just had you drop in from the chat, just tell us where you practice, and are you a clinician or an embryologist?
Yes, my name is Joseph Doyle. I'm one of the providers at Shady Grove Fertility.
And are you you're a reproductive
one of the MDs.
Great, thanks so much. So I guess the question is directed to Nicole first. Nicole, we have our hot question from the audience of the night, and we have the technology now to bring anyone live from around the world. So let's just see what people, you know, Persian's 42, 43, and she says, if I don't freeze, my chance is zero, so would you do it?
You know, we do get that statement a lot from patients. They say, not even zero, if I don't freeze today, a year from now, it's going to be worse. But, you know, if you're talking about something that's negligible to start with, what does worse really mean? So, you know, we don't make people leave. If they say, I want to freeze, even if it means I'm going to only increase my chance of pregnancy by 2 or 3 or 5%, we'll allow them to try. And even if they have two eggs to freeze, we'll allow them to freeze. But I feel it really behooves the clinician to be really direct about this. And that's why we did this model to figure out how many eggs, and literally came up with you needed 50 eggs if you were over 42 to even consider having a baby with frozen eggs, you know. So I don't know. If your patient was willing to do it like 3 or 4 cycles, it might be worth it.
And I'm going to ask the authors, what about you? Would you let them do it?
I think we would agree with Dr. Noyes here that we would heavily discourage it. We would really recommend that they attempt conception at the current time with perhaps donor sperm, as that's the most likely way for them to conceive. But we agree. We would let them try, and you know, with full disclosure about the low likelihood of success.
Great. Thank you. All right. So we have a little more than 10 minutes left. I'm going to ask Nicole. You had a paper in the same issue of fertility and sterility. Your group published a paper asking basically almost the same question. Yours was called Baby Budgeting, Oocyte Cryopreservation in Women Delaying Reproduction Can Reduce Cost Per Live Birth. Can you tell us what was your take-home message from your study? Was it the same or different?
Well, first of all, we worked really hard on that title, so why didn't you choose our paper over the other one to discuss first? No, I actually commend the authors in North Carolina, and I really like the data, particularly Figure 2 for anyone who's listening. I find Figure 2 will be very, very helpful. I actually used it twice today, believe it or not, in my office hours to show the difference between freezing and not freezing. In our model, Kate Devine, who was a resident at NYU and then a fellow at the NIH, along with some of the residents and a medical student, Sarah Druckenmiller, got together, and we set up this very complex model because the NIH was involved. And, you know, it started with women who were 35. They either froze or didn't freeze at 35, and then they were attempting conception at 40. So first they attempted for 6 months naturally, then they could do 2 cycles of IVF, and then they could thaw their eggs. And what we found is that up until the age of 38, it was actually cost-effective to freeze eggs before. And, for instance, at the age of 35, if you froze, the cost went down by $15,000, and the chance of live birth probability went up by 20% if you froze your eggs versus not freezing. So I found this paper, I found the Mercero, the North Carolina group paper, to just reinforce what we found. I don't really find the data different at all, that we found that it was worthwhile to freeze up until about the age of 37. Even from a cost, if you account for cost effectiveness.
Great, thanks. Mike, we're coming up to near the end. I think you have a few more questions.
Yeah, our next question is directed toward Dr. Williams. Dr. Robinshaw?
Dr. Williams, we would like to know if and how this paper will influence your counseling to patients with regards to using fresh donor eggs versus frozen donor eggs?
That's an excellent question. We have almost 300 DFE cycles, and we found that actually the pregnancy rates are very similar to fresh eggs. And so at this point, we're moving towards actually over 50% now of our donor egg cycles or our DFE cycles. This paper certainly just the assumptions would certainly go along with overall applying the technology of DFE to just general expectations for social egg freezing, since we don't really get a lot of data from social egg freezing at this point. The results mainly come from frozen donor egg cycles. So we do that very routinely now.
Okay, let me bring back our group from Cincinnati.
All right. Our next question is directed to Dr. Pomeroy from Dr. Adams.
Dr. Pomeroy, do you think as lab techniques improve that this model in terms of its conclusions will be applicable in terms of pregnancy and live birth rate?
You know, I don't see that we are going to have a time when we are going to have a great increase in pregnancy rates over what we already get with this technology. I mean, there might be something that comes up like ultrasound transfers or new media or ICSI that will affect us, but even slow cooling, the rates did not change very much, and we used that technology for many, many years. I don't see a lot of changes happening that will affect the model.
I'm going to tell you, we just asked the audience, will you repeat cycles until a set number of eggs are frozen? Because we were talking about this, how many eggs do you need? And 10% said no, they offer a single free cycle, and that's what you get. 29% said yes, until they reach a target number of eggs. and 62% said, yes, as many as the patient desires, they'll just keep going until the patient feels that, that they've had enough. All right, I'm going to go back to Cincinnati.
Our next question I will ask will be directed toward the authors. What was your rationale in the assumption that an individual would attempt conception unassisted for 6 months, then proceed directly to IVF versus a long unassisted period or other less invasive techniques like ovulation induction?
Well, to answer the first part of that question, we use 6 months because of the definition of infertility after age 35. You know, you could argue that we should have used a year prior to 35. In order to do that, we would have had to sacrifice some of the, I think, the strongest parts of our paper, which is the great data on natural fertility rates. We only had 6 months data for that group. The second part of the question is, you know, should we have used IUIs? And the model is probably overly complex to start with. To add another variable or several variables to it would have made it even more so. It would be helpful to only be used in the arm that does not freeze their oocytes. I can't imagine someone who froze their oocytes going through IUIs if they were infertile. But it would be good to add in the new model.
Okay, great. Now, we're coming up to the end of our time, so we're going to start to summarize. I guess, Michael, I'll ask you on behalf of our host department, I want to thank you so much for doing this. What do you think is your take-home message from the paper and the discussion for our worldwide audience and everyone watching this broadcast live on YouTube? What's the take-home message we should give people tonight?
Well, I think that both from the paper from Dr. Noyes, from Dr. Mesereau's group and from Dr. Noyes' group, I think that oocyte freezing needs to be considered. Obviously, it appears to be cost-effective once you get to a certain age. I think that there are a lot of positives to that message, and I think that hopefully this paper will open up the thought process of freezing eggs possibly later, that patients, it may give patients the opportunity to say that I can wait for a few years, but as Dr. Schoolcraft and Dr. Suri may have mentioned earlier, I think that if a patient comes in at any age and has that discussion with you and you counsel them on the results of this paper and other papers, if they still want to freeze their eggs, I would still think that egg freezing should be a rational legitimate track for them to take.
Fantastic. Nicole, I'm going to ask you the same question, both as a discussant and an author on this topic. What do you think should be our take-home message for the audience that they should, what do you want them to learn from our discussion tonight?
Well, I don't think that egg freezing's for everyone. I mean, you can't have a 44-year-old coming in and saying, okay, I'm ready. I'm not ready for a baby, but I'm ready to freeze. And I do have people come in and say things like that. I think that egg freezing is very reasonable to do up to the age of 38. It's acceptable to do up to the age of 42 if you have good ovarian reserve. It is showing to be cost effective. I mean, doing five IVF cycles on someone who's 43 who has borderline ovarian reserve, is that cost effective? You know, and insurance companies will cover that. You know, it's just crazy. So I think one of our goals should really be to get oocyte cryopreservation covered by insurance companies in specific cases, particularly for cancer, but also for elective indications.
Great. Eric and Bill from Colorado, I'm going to ask you the same question from the discussion in your practice. What would you want the take-home message that our worldwide audience should get from this today?
Well, I think it's important for patients, for the public in general, to know that this is available, because that's the first step. And the thought of one being able to delay for an endless period of time is clearly not appropriate. But I think it's also appropriate for women to know that they need to have a full evaluation, and not every 35-year-old is the same as every other 35-year-old. And so they really, it's the clinician's job to appropriately counsel the patient who has an interest in this very exciting technology.
That's fantastic. Thank you. I also want to share with everyone a little bit of our poll. We asked people, now that they're finishing up, what do they think is the optimal age now that we've had our discussion tonight? 3% said under 30, 81% said 30 to 35 is the optimal age, and 35 to 40 was 16%. So we've moved the number down and where people think they should be freezing. We also asked people how many eggs they think is ideal. 11% said no ideal number, 20% said 10, 11% 15, 23% said 20, and 34% said as many eggs as they can get, no absolute number. So you can see there's still a lot of uncertainty about how we apply this new technology. I'm going to ask our other panelists. Diana, do you have a take-home message for the audience?
As others, I agree that the papers seems to really suggest a cost-effective benefit for women pursuing egg freezing in their mid-30s, echoing the consensus that perhaps between 30 to 35 may prove to be the most beneficial. And I also agree with what Dr. Suri had mentioned earlier of having and analyzing your individual institutional rates of warming success or survival of warming and fertilization and blastulation rates, and then finally the age-related aneuploidy rates to then finally counsel patients of how many eggs is enough.
Great, fantastic. Dan, thanks for joining us from Houston. Any last words of advice for our audience, take-home message that you'd want them to learn from our discussion?
No, I think all of this information is extremely important, and I think clearly counseling the patient is key, both from your own data, and also it's very useful to look at models like this, since the only real data you're going to likely have from your own program would be that of DFE cycles, which would be in egg donors and younger patients. This is extremely helpful.
Great, fantastic. Now, you know, as a testament to the value of this, I'm really excited to share the results of our last few polls with you. We asked the audience, will you change how you practice based on tonight's discussion? You know, we spent an hour together, we had the authors of the paper, we had a second paper, we asked people, will you change how you practice? 65% of the audience said that they're going to change what they do as a result of tonight's discussion, and that's really fantastic. And we asked people, you know, did you think that this format was valuable tonight? 100% of our audience said that they did, and they enjoyed this interactive discussion and our ability to share what everyone's doing. With that, I'm going to finish up and thank everyone for their time. I especially want to thank the authors. It's not easy to put yourself out in public and be critiqued, but I think we really learned a lot from you. Tolga and Jenny, thanks so much for being with us. Everyone else, Dan, Diana, the group from Colorado, Kimball, and Micah for doing the chat, Nicole, and Mike Thomas, thanks so much to you and all your group and all the effort you put in. I hope you enjoyed your time with us tonight.
Fun. It was fun. We'd also like to make sure everyone knows that Dr. April Batchelor just flew in from Portugal and arrived with us, so I'm glad she was able to participate as well.
Great. Thanks so much. And so we want to conclude our event tonight. I want to tell everyone we'll be back again next month with our monthly Journal Club live platform events where we discuss cutting-edge breakthroughs in reproductive medicine. The only journal to have a live, direct, unfiltered discussion with panelists from around the world. I want to thank ASRM and the Board of Directors and Fertility and Sterility and the Editorial Board for allowing us to do this. Thank Lodestone Technology for the platform that enables us to do this. And thank you, everyone in chat, for joining us, sharing your thoughts, and helping us advance what we do and take better care of our patients with cutting-edge technology. We don't have to wait a year for a conference. Right now, live, we found out what everyone around the world is doing. Thanks so much for your time, and thank you so much for being with us. We'll see you again next month.
Yeah. Nice.